Do you hate ads?
Do you hate Elon Musk?
Do you wish you could automatically mute everyone associated with the New York Times? Are you upset that which billionaire owns Twitter determines how the algorithm works and which political party is censored? Do you not want to pay $8 a month to get your tweets noticed? Have you tried using Mastodon and realized that it's a complete nightmare and probably more prone to censorship and than Twitter? Good news, Nostr exists. Nostr, or Nostr, I don't really know how to pronounce it. Nostr stands for notes or stuff transmitted over relays, which sort of hints at the protocol's architecture, which is something that we'll cover later on in the video. Basically, it's a very simple messaging protocol, and it's important that it's so simple because that's what's going to allow it to scale really well to the size of something like Twitter. And the interesting part about Nostr, and sort of the elephant in the room with this whole thing, is that there is no blockchain underlying Nostr. It's been forced into our heads so much over the last, say, 5 years by all of these decentralized altcoins that you need to have a blockchain and a token to create decentralized software, which is simply not true. The Tor network doesn't have a blockchain. When BitTorrent started, there was no blockchain. And it's refreshing to see actually decentralized technology being built without the use of blockchains. So next, let's jump into a visual example of how Nostr works and how its architecture is meaningfully different than Twitter and how it achieves decentralization without a blockchain. All right, guys, so I think because this whole like decentralized technology thing gets so complicated when you're just talking about it without some sort of visual representation, I thought that it would be good if I could sort of draw out Nostr's architecture here for you on the iPad. And hopefully this is going to give you a really good understanding of how Nostr is different than Twitter. Okay, so if you think of Twitter, it's a private company, right? And the whole app really exists within this private company box, right? So there's users, and these users have, you know, profiles, and the users have the ability to make posts into this like giant feed that everyone is reading from. But if at any point Twitter gets mad at a user, Twitter, this private company, some guy at this company can just say, okay, you know, Elon Musk says, I don't want Rhett to post on Twitter anymore. And so then I'm gone, and all the messages that I wrote, if I wrote that message and I wrote this message, all those messages are gone too. So how does Nostr fix this? This is gonna be Nostr. Couldn't find a Nostr logo, so you're just gonna have to pretend. And so what is Nostr? Nostr is just a messaging protocol. And that's, you know, really fancy words. What the f is a protocol? A protocol is just, in this case, a standard that says that if you give me a message that is, in the case of Nostr, just a bunch of text that's formatted as JSON. If you give me a bunch of text and it says it's from, you know, Rhett's public key, and the message is hello world, and it could be from anyone and it could be any message. If you give me something that's of this format, Nostr is going to recognize what this is. It's going to recognize that this is a Nostr message. It's going to recognize that this is something that we can show on the Nostr protocol, on the Nostr network. And so how is Nostr showing these messages, or how is Nostr surfacing these messages? Nostr has something called relays. And the relays are basically just channels that host messages. So these orange lines that I just drew here, these are going to be the relays, and living on a relay is all these different messages. So we can see here, maybe the white messages are messages that I'm posting, maybe the purple messages are from Elon Musk, and maybe the green messages are from Joe Biden. And so if you subscribe to any of these relays, my messages are on every relay, as you can see the white messages right there. But if you notice Elon Musk's purple messages, they're only on two of these relays. And so maybe this third relay is saying, I don't want to host Elon Musk's messages, but I'm cool to host Rhett's messages, and I'm cool to host Joe Biden's messages. And then maybe I do something that upsets, you know, the guy that's running this top relay, and he says, all right, I'm done with Rhett, get rid of all of his messages, we're not going to have him on our platform anymore. And so now on this first relay, it's just Elon Musk's messages. But that's totally fine, because if my followers just subscribe to the second relay or this third relay, all my messages are still stored on those relays. And if those two relays were then like, yeah, Rhett sucks, we're going to get rid of his messages too, what I could do is in my house, I could just get a Raspberry Pi or some sort of small computer. I could host my own Nostr relay, because the ability to host a relay is, you know, totally open source. Anyone can do that. And I would say, all right, you know, no one wants to host my messages. I'm going to host all my own messages on my own relay. So this is going to be called Rhett's relay. And let's say I get totally removed from these other ones. So I've been totally removed, and now all my messages just live on my own relay. What I can do is, maybe there's some fourth relay up here that a lot of people are subscribed to. I could say, hey, this relay doesn't hate me. I'm willing to pay, you know, $5 to them a month or something. And
and they'll host all the messages on this relay on this relay. And so now I'm back into, you know, the public consciousness of relays that, you know, people are actually using and subscribing to. And in reality, if this goes to scale, it's not that there's going to be four relays, it's that there's going to be like, you know, thousands or hundreds of thousands or millions of relays, and I'll have the ability to talk to somebody, you know, maybe if everyone in the United States hates me, maybe some guy in Kazakhstan doesn't hate me and he's willing to host my relay. He has a really popular relay. It's not as big as the New York Times' relay, but you know, it's enough for me to get my message out. And so if I back up all my messages to my own relay, I'll have the ability to go talk to someone else and get my messages put onto their relay as well. Because it's unlikely that everyone in the entire planet hates me. And so then the third piece to all of this is what's called clients or applications. So there's these relays that are hosting messages, but how do we as just regular people that are not, you know, super hardcore techies, how do we interact with these messages like we would on something like a Twitter? So there's a big client on iOS right now called Damus, like Nostradamus. And Damus is very similar to Twitter. If you open up the Damus app, it looks really, really similar to Twitter. So here is what Twitter looks like. And here right next to it is what Damus looks like. So you can see that Twitter is maybe a little bit more aesthetic than Damus, right? It's got its little logo. It's got my lists up here and stuff. But Damus looks really good. It's basically the same. The functionality is basically the same. You've got DMs down here. You've got sort of a search functionality here, and you've got notifications down here. And you've got the ability actually to interact with Jack, the founder of Twitter. He's actually a huge fan of Damus and of the Nostr protocol in general. It seems like Nostr is sort of fulfilling his vision for what he wanted to build over at Twitter. So Jack gave some funding to Nostr, and right now Damus is a really cool place. You're able to interact with a lot of these guys from Bitcoin Twitter in a much more private setting, obviously, than having to like sift through all of the crazy that's over on regular Twitter, where there's, you know, millions of people trying to compete for attention. There might be some open source clients, but clients are basically just private companies. Here's another client called Astral.ninja, and this is a desktop client. You can see the user interface of Astral.ninja is pretty meaningfully different from Damus and Twitter. It kind of looks the way that Twitter does on desktop, but what's really interesting here is you can see, I took these two Damus and Astral.ninja screenshots, you know, just a couple seconds apart, and you can actually see that the messages are exactly the same, right? So I'm getting the exact same messages on both of these services because they are just looking at a bunch of different relays. And there is some relay overlap probably between these two services. And so if they're both taking all the messages from like these 10 relays down here, then the messages that I see when I use each of these totally different applications is going to be exactly the same. And you can sort of think of it as if like you open your internal company Slack and you're able to, from your Slack account, send messages to Twitter, or maybe from your WhatsApp where you're just DMing with your friend, you're then able to DM the same friend over on Twitter and have the exact same message conversation across both of the apps. You can see here in Astral.ninja is a good example. There's this messages tab. It would be like if this messages tab, if we opened it up in Slack, exact same messages. So like during your workday, you're able to interact with whoever you're talking to over on Astral.ninja, but you're also able to just, you know, have the same conversations that you're having in your internal company Slack. Because maybe your internal company Slack, you know, it looks at the internal company relay, but it also looks at one of the relays that is public that, you know, Astral.ninja is hosting. So hopefully these visuals are helping it make a little bit more sense to you. I know I was very confused the first time I heard all of this, like, oh, it's a protocol, it's a relay, you know, what is a client? What does Damus do? I was really confused the first time I heard all those things, and I hope that seeing it visually was a big help. If you do like visual tutorials like this, definitely let me know down in the comments. Next, let's go ahead and jump into what are the benefits of a protocol like Nostr.
When I've explained Nostr to people in my life, they've sort of come at me with all of this energy like, oh, Rhett, why does Nostr need to exist? Twitter is great. Why do we need alternatives? And I think the use cases of Nostr are immediately obvious if you take more than 5 seconds to think about it. But let's go ahead in this next part of the video and sort of talk about what a decentralized alternative to Twitter, in this case Nostr, what the promise of Nostr really is. The first issue that Nostr really solves is this idea of users getting banned. Over at Twitter, if sort of the regime of Twitter disagrees with your political philosophy or just something that you've done, you can be banned from the service. And we've seen people on both sides of the political spectrum being banned and getting upset about being banned. In Nostr, any single relay could theoretically ban you, but it doesn't really matter because there should be hundreds or thousands or tens of thousands of other other relays that would be more than willing to host your messages, especially if you were paying them to host your messages. So if your relay hates Elon Musk, you can ban him. And if your relay hates Joe Biden, you can ban him too. But there will be other relays that are willing to host messages from those people. And since users are identified by their own public keys, they're not going to lose their messaging history if your relay deletes them. The bottom line is that no single relay will be able to turn off the speech of an individual person, because there will always be relays willing to host that person's speech. Sort of on that note, there's the idea of censorship resistance. If the Chinese government wants to go turn off Twitter, they can do that, and they've successfully done that to platforms like Google and Facebook in their country. However, with Nostr, it's going to be really hard to stop someone from running a Nostr relay, and because of that, it will be very difficult to censor an individual person's message from getting out of a nation state or some other kind of corrupt institution. In the same way that no one can really stop you from broadcasting to the radio, no one will be able to stop you from broadcasting to Nostr. Nostr is also going to help with the whole spam situation. If you go on Twitter today, there's maybe a little bit less spam and bot than there was when Elon Musk took over Twitter, but I think we're starting to see the evolution of bots and spam getting a little more sophisticated, to the point that now the bots and spam that's on Twitter, it looks a lot like the bots and spam that are in my YouTube comments. And so then Twitter will need to create new models to get rid of those new bots, and it will be a constant arms race unless something is done fundamentally that will stop bots forever. And the obvious solution to this is to implement some sort of cost to posting messages or to spamming a network. If it costs you and I half a cent to send a tweet, we're just individuals, that's not going to be a meaningful amount of money for us, and we're totally fine to pay that cost. But if you're a bot that's sending 10,000 tweets per second, that's going to be a meaningful amount of money for you, and that small cost is going to deter you from posting over and over and over again and spamming the network. Some Nostr clients have already implemented the Bitcoin Lightning Network for payments, and so I think as development goes on, this spam problem is going to become not as big of an issue on Nostr, because clients will be able to implement costs using the Lightning Network to stop people from just sending millions of messages out into the network and spamming everyone. As for scalability, the architecture of Nostr is scalable to start hosting larger and larger file types like photos and videos. If large companies with massive data centers start to run their own relays, which I think is an inevitability if the network gets big enough. Scalability has been a huge problem with other decentralized Twitter alternatives like Mastodon, which have turned out to not really be the town square that everyone thought that they would be, but instead sort of little siloed pockets of servers with different rules. And it seems like each one of those little servers has its own mini dictator that can ban you from the server. And so people have found out that Mastodon is actually even worse than Twitter from a getting banned for the things that you say perspective. And then even if the architecture never gets that big, amateurs will still have the ability to host their own relays. And while they might be smaller, everyone having their own relay is going to deliver on the promise of free speech. On top of relay diversity, there will also be client diversity. And so for example, you might have a Nostr client like Twitter that is sort of an open public square where everyone can communicate with everyone else. But you could also have a Nostr client that's more like Slack that is sort of reading off of an internal company relay and allowing people within a single organization to interact with each other. Because Nostr is an open messaging protocol, you can really take every app that's meant for messaging and replace it with some sort of Nostr alternative. So it's not just that this is a decentralized Twitter. This is a full decentralized messaging platform. It could take over things like Slack. It could take over things like Twitter. It could even replace things like WhatsApp and Signal that are meant for direct peer-to-peer messaging. The possibilities for Nostr are really endless, and if there's some example that you guys have thought of that I haven't mentioned during the course of this video, definitely go down below and leave a comment. I'm really interested to hear all the different ideas of what Nostr could be used for in the future. So to get started with Nostr, if you do have an iPhone, there's a great app that's currently in beta called Damus. Nostr, Damus, get it? As of the recording of this video, Damus is still in test flight, and the test flight beta is like full to the brim. They're not accepting any more people, but you can sign up for a waitlist, I think, and I'll have a link for that down in the description. And then if you're watching this video far into the future, I appreciate you, thank you. But hopefully Damus should be released on the App Store if you're watching this like months or years into the future. As for Android clients, as of the recording of this video, I'm not aware of any, but there is active development going on in trying to port Damus over to Android, and then also just building out different Android Nostr clients. So in the meantime, while these mobile clients are not really up and running and ready to accept new users, you can can always go and take advantage of web browser-based clients like Astral.ninja. Astral.ninja is one of the most comprehensive clients from a feature perspective, so you should be able to get up and running pretty easily with Astral.ninja and fully interact with most of the big features that Nostr has to offer. If you do get stuck getting set up, definitely go down below and leave a comment or DM me over on Twitter, and I'll do my best to help you get unstuck. I also am going to leave a link in the description to a list of Nostr clients that's being maintained over on GitHub. Hopefully, because it is on GitHub, the community will update that page over time and we'll be able to sort of just get a quick look at it and see, all right, what is the best Nostr client for my personal use case? I think for most people, Astral.ninja is going to be the answer. If you guys want to learn more, I'll have some learning resources down in the description. The first is going to be a link to Nostr's GitHub where you can see Nostr's code and understand how it works. There's also a lot of good FAQs and some great examples of what Nostr is and what the use cases of Nostr are going to be or are thought to be in the future. The second is going to be a blog post from my friend Greg White, who a couple weeks ago was talking about the future of Nostr and some of its potential applications. And then finally, I'll have a podcast link down there with Preston Pish interviewing the founder of the iOS Damus app. And if you were confused or overwhelmed by the information that I gave you in this video, that podcast, I think, is going to really help you better understand what Nostr is, how it works, and then also the future of the Damus app. And I'll also have some tutorials down there telling you how you can verify your Nostr account, either through a website that you own and control, or if you're not as technical, through a third-party service, so you can get a cool checkmark next to your name on Astral.ninja or on Damus so that people can see that you're real and that you're not a bot. Let me know down below if you want to see any Nostr tutorials or any more Nostr content in the future, or if you have any questions about anything that I covered in this video, I do still respond to all the comments. Subscribe for new content every Monday at 10 a.m. Eastern. Check out these videos over here to learn more about Bitcoin. I love you all. Goodbye.